I'm going to talk about this. This is an important curve that will help us save and solve the climate crisis. But not if it looks like this. So we need to flip it so it turns up. This is the pace of many climate solutions we have today. We are scaling electric cars, we're scaling solar energy, wind power, battery storage. And it's happening on exponential growth speed. That means that we don't really see the effect of it when we're here, but we're going to see sudden change when we are up here. So this is great. There's only one problem, and that is we need that to happen very, very fast. And currently, we have a political leadership in this world that are not really speeding up this transition. They are slowing it down instead. And The Guardian recently, they did a survey where they asked everyone working on those solutions, those that are implementing the solution, they asked them, do you believe that we are going to solve the climate crisis and halve the emission before the year 2030? And only 6% said yes. Only 6% of the people working with implementing the solution believes that we are going to make it. I'm one of those crazy people that thinks that we can make it, but even I am starting to doubt, because we are currently in the year 2024, soon 2025, and we are still increasing the emissions. They're starting to flat out, but they're not decreasing. And we need to cut it in half in about 5 years. So that's a very big challenge. Okay, is that a big problem? If it just take 3 more years, will it matter? I just read a study from International Energy Agency that are saying that in the year 2033, solar energy will be the biggest energy source in the world. But that's 2033, it's 3 years later. So why is this deadline 2030 and halving emissions so important? I will illustrate it. They said I was not allowed to use a PowerPoint, so I will use some other things. I will illustrate it with this chair. This is the climate crisis today. We're kind of leaning backwards. And the more emission we put up there, the more we're leaning it. But we can still do this, right? The problem, if we pass 1.5 degree and we're very near, we're kind of there, but if we stay there and we just keep going up, there is a big, big risk of hitting a tipping point. And when we hit a tipping point, this chair will be very, very hard to put back up. Maybe we can do it in some mysterious way, but we don't know how to do that, so we must make sure to not tip this chair. And I can just give a short personal story to just kind of tell you why this is so important. It's not like we are giving up if this happens, but it makes everything so much harder to really solve the problem. When I was starting We Don't Have Time, my own mother died in cancer just 1 year before. And she died of cancer. It started with breast cancer. That was, you know, the tipping. It was starting to tilt. But when it was spreading all over, everywhere, that was when it became, you know, terminal. So this is what we must avoid for the climate. And we have a cure for this. We need, the only thing we need in order to make it is more time. We need to buy more time. If we get more time, this will happen. And it's not just the solutions, the technology and the business. It's also more than 80% globally, according to a UN survey, among people wants to have stronger climate action. And now we feel the resistance from the politicians. But when we're up here, they will not resist the green transition because the green transition are the majority. In China, last month, we have 51% of new cars are electric. Do anyone here believe that in 2 years from now, it will be 49% electric cars? Of course not. So the policy will change when the technology changes, but we need more time. So how can we get more time? I will demonstrate it. The problem, here's the problem. Carbon dioxide, you all know this. This is a big part of the climate crisis. And the problem with carbon dioxide, when we emit it, it will go up. And it will stay up there for up to 1,000 years. Maybe we can kind of try to remove it, but it looks kind of hard to do it, very expensive. But there's another solution out there. And that is, I will say, it is another problem out there. That is methane. Methane is another greenhouse gas. It's a very common greenhouse gas. It's the second biggest contributor to global warming. And there's a big difference between methane and carbon dioxide. When we release this, it comes down again. On average, 12 years. It's a big difference between 1,000 years, 12 years. So the solution here is that we need to stop emit methane. And if we do that, we can actually reverse global warming with up to 0.5 degrees. That is the time we need to do everything else because we still need to stop the carbon dioxide. So this is great news. And where does this methane come from? Three big sources. This is one of the sources. Bananas. Waste. Food waste. When we eat food, we maybe not eat it all. I mean, I don't want to eat this this shell. We throw it away, right? And what happened with this, it becomes methane. 20% of methane emission comes from waste. But guess what? When I arrived here this morning, I took the bus, and the bus in Sweden, in Stockholm, are powered with bioenergy produced by food waste instead of methane. So there's a solution for that. Sweden has solved it. We just need to invest and share this knowledge to all countries. We don't emit hardly any methane from waste. So other countries can do the same. And another thing we in Sweden don't have, we don't have any fossil fuel extraction. This is supposed to be a pipeline. You need to have a little bit fantasy here. But here is a lot of natural gas and things. So 45% from methane comes from the fossil fuel industry. And it's a lot of leakage here. It's kind of broken. It's a lot of methane. And this is a lot of emission that is really easy to fix. It's just fix the pipe. You have some from coal mines, etc. But you can fix that. The solutions exist. It costs some money. But the fossil fuel industry can absolutely afford it. So we have a solution for waste. We have a solution for fossil fuel industry. What's the largest source of methane gas? I think you know it. It's also in the fridge. Milk. Cows are burping 4 times every 5 minutes. And that adds up to, agriculture adds up to 40% of the methane emissions. So how are we going to stop that? I mean, of course, everyone can turn vegan tomorrow, but I don't think that is politically possible. So we need technology for it. And there exists technology. There is actually a solution out there. Many companies working on this, where you have a food additive, and you give that to the cows, and they burp up to 80% less. So we can fix that as well. We're going to hear more about those solutions later today. So this is great news. We have the solutions. But how are we making sure that this will happen? So that that will not happen. How can we make it, how can we make it happen? I don't think it will be enough for me just doing crazy stuff on stage here, maybe helping some with awareness, but We need something else. We need a lot of money because the farmers will not afford giving that additive to the farmers. The fossil industry, however, can afford it, but they're not doing it, so we need to make them that. Maybe make it illegal to release a lot of dangerous gases in there. So what do we need? We need to look at the fridge. This is the solution. I'm talking about 1987. I was 8 years old, and we had a big environment disaster. I'm talking about freons. All the fridges we had when I was a kid were powered by a dangerous gas. And when that was released up in the air, it was destroying the ozone layer. And this was a super dangerous thing. In fact, if we hadn't fixed it, we will not be able to walk outside today and show naked skin. The climate crisis will not be our problem. We will be living in a destroyed world. But we're not doing that because the industry, the manufacturers of the fridges, the chemical companies, and bold world leaders met in Montreal, where they decided to ban freons, phase it out, put the funding behind it. And today we have perfectly fresh food and we don't use freon anymore. Isn't it great? This is the biggest success of UN history. Maybe the only big success in the environment, but it saved humanity once. So we can do it twice. Right. The Buy More campaign is all about sharing knowledge about this and gather the stakeholders in the UN system to host a new Montreal conference and agreeing on a short, very, very fast, rapid phase out of short-lived climate gases. Methane is the biggest source. There are some others. They're also easy to just quit. This doesn't mean that we're doing this instead of stopping the carbon dioxide. It just means that we're going to be able to have some more time doing everything else we need to do. And there is one more thing. We're at a tech conference, so we must have one more thing. This is where it becomes really exciting. This year in Mars, there was a new satellite launched that is called the Methane satellite. And it will measure open data where we have emission from methane, leakage from the fossil fuel industry, from everywhere we have methane gas. It will measure that, and we will know exactly where we need to fix the problem. We don't have that for any other climate gases, but we have it for methane. So a legal system, some funding, and the data is everything we need. And this is what Buy More Time is all about. We can do this.